W.F. House presents an unabridged recording of The Key to Finding Jack by Ewa Jozefkowicz, narrated by Charlie Sanderson. Chapter 1. So listen to this one. You have a treasure chest that you want to send me in the post. Each of us has our own padlock with a key. But you don't have the key to my padlock, and I don't have the key to yours. How can you send me the treasure chest and make sure nobody else can open it? We were sitting on Jack's bed, staring out through the skylight. I was supposed to be in my own room, fast asleep, but I'd sneaked up the stairs, as I did so often. Being 6 years older than me, Jack stayed up until whatever time he wanted, and he was hardly ever asleep when I crept in. That night, I could already hear the familiar engine roar. I knew without checking the clock that it was the 10:15 p.m. flight to New York. Right on cue, the flashing dot appeared in the black square of Jack's skylight. I like to imagine all the people sitting in the plane waiting to reach their destination. I even made up stories about them. The old lady going to visit her businessman son, who'd recently started working in Manhattan. A newly married couple, off on their honeymoon, drinking champagne and kissing. And, in the row in front of them, a family with loads of kids coming home after spending a few weeks in London over the summer holidays. The stewardesses were a bit annoyed because the kids kept getting out of their seats and running up and down the aisle, colliding with the food and drinks trolleys. I tried to focus my mind on Jack's riddle. Easy, I would send you the key in a separate envelope. Only you and I would know what it's for, I declared triumphantly. Nah, come on, Flick, you can do better than that. It could easily be intercepted. I racked my brain. Oh, I don't know. Crack the padlock open with a hammer? I asked, although I knew it was the wrong answer. You have to be subtler than that. If it's possible to force it open, anyone could. Think harder, Sergeant. We had a joke from when we were little, that Jack was a detective doing lots of undercover work, and I was his main contact in the police force. He'd explained that this role was much more important than being his assistant, which I always wanted to be, because it meant heading up the detective operations in the field. The difference is that all your work is legal. Some of what I do is undercover and shady. Together, we make a great team, though. The roles were perfect, because I loved to follow rules and Jack hated them. One of his absolute favourite things was to make people laugh. He often got away with his practical jokes, and when he didn't, he got detentions. Quite a lot of them. That made Dad really cross, especially now, as Jack was supposed to be concentrating on his work and getting into uni. Then Mum would be cross because Dad was cross, and normally Mum was on Jack's side. Dad said she was overprotective of him, but Jack was also cleverer than anyone I knew and could solve the hardest puzzles and mysteries in seconds. Remember that working out a riddle might take a few steps. Let me start you off. You have your own padlock with a key. You send me the chest with your locked padlock attached. I receive it, but instead of trying to open the chest, I add my padlock to it, also locked. Then I send it back to you. Is it beginning to make sense? You'd be receiving the same chest, but this time with two padlocks.
Of course. I unlock my padlock and send the chest back to you with only your padlock attached. And you can unlock it and get the treasure.
He held up his hand for a high five. Jack was like that, helping me towards the answer, but making me feel I got there myself. He passed me his box of chocolate frogs, and I sucked on one happily, even though I'd brushed my teeth. At first, the mix of minty toothpaste and chocolate was disgusting, but I knew that after about 30 seconds, my mouth would be filled with caramelly wonder. Each time I cracked one of Jack's puzzles, I immediately felt sleepy, and he had to pinch me to send me back to my own room. But that night, I was determined to stay awake for as long as possible, because it would be the last time in ages we'd be able to have this kind of conversation face to face. In the corner of his room, by the window, my brother's rucksack was already packed, and his passport and plane tickets were lying on the bedside table. Jack would be gone for a whole 10 months. He wouldn't be with us when we went to the fireworks for my birthday in November.
he wouldn't bring me huge sticks of marshmallows like he did every year and tell me the names of all the weird and wonderful flashes in the sky. I could never tell which were real and which he'd made up on the spot. He'd also miss Christmas. Grandma Sylvie would come round, as she did every year, and complain about her aches and pains, and without Jack, there would be nobody to distract her by suggesting a card game or giving us all some really complicated puzzles to solve. I tried not to think about it too much, because it made a painful ball, which I couldn't swallow, form in my throat. So as I sat there, looking up at the skylight, I tried to think about everything other than Jack leaving, which was easier said than done. I told myself that I would remember this evening as the night of the treasure chest, because otherwise it would have to be the night before Jack left. I kept replaying the short birthday greetings film that Jack had sent me from Brazil. It was strange seeing him there on the beach when Mum and I were in the middle of our Christmas shopping. We went to Uncle Michael's for New Year's Eve dinner, and when I lit my sparkler, I made a couple of important resolutions. The first was that I would finally complete at least one of the stories that were swarming in my head, inspired by Jack's riddles. The second was that I would persuade Dad to pay for us all to visit Jack. On the wall calendar that he made for me, I kept counting down the days that he'd been away, and fortunately, time was passing quite quickly. The new term started and we were set an exciting writing project in English. Otherwise, life carried on as normal. There were no signs that everything was about to change. Even the flashing lights of the 10:15 p.m. to New York still sped reliably past Jack's skylight night after night. But then, halfway through January, the boy who used to lie watching them was somewhere on the other side of the world, caught in what the lipstick newsreader on TV said was one of the worst natural disasters in living history. Chapter 2. It was a Thursday afternoon in the middle of English class. We'd been reading Sherlock Holmes and the Case of the Silk Stocking, and Mrs. Emmett had set us the best possible assignment: to write our own detective story. My discussions with Jack had given me so many great ideas. I'd even jotted some down in a special book of riddle tales, which I kept under my bed. I promised myself that one day I would type them up on Mum's laptop. I just hadn't found the time to do it yet. Now, after only half an hour, I'd managed to fill more than 3 pages. Kira was sitting next to me, twisting one of her braids round and round her finger and biting her tongue in concentration. I glanced at her exercise book and saw that she'd written a short paragraph which had more words crossed out than left in.
"Oi, stop copying,"
she whispered, winking at me. Kira and I had been friends since nursery, and we were good at completely different things. I love English, history and geography, anything that involves a story, while Kira is great at maths and science and likes things that have a definite answer. Being friends means we can help each other with stuff the other person isn't so good at.
"I can't think of a story to save my life," she whispered to me now. "Do you think anyone will notice if I adapt one of the episodes of Crime Fighters that I watched with Mum the other week? It's on a weird channel. Probably not that many people would have seen it."
"Go for it," I told her. "Everyone busy with their work?" said Mrs. Emmett, raising her eyebrow at us. "I see that some of you have lost your concentration. Before we finish for the day, it might be helpful to hear your opening paragraphs. I want to feel that dramatic tension and the slow revealing of clues that Arthur Conan Doyle is so good at. Does anyone want to volunteer?" Her question was met with silence. "All right, I will," said a low voice with an American accent from the back of the class. "Thank you, Duncan. Come to the front." "Do I have to? I can read sitting down." "You'll be able to project your voice better facing the class." Duncan seemed to take ages getting to the whiteboard. His best friends and sidekicks, Max and Elliot, slapped him on the back for good luck. As always, everything about him looked immaculate. His shoes were clean, his trousers barely had a crease, and his shirt was tucked in. Even though I couldn't see his exercise book from here, I sensed that he probably had super neat handwriting.
"His dad's a famous author. He's won some important awards,"
Kira had told me when Duncan had joined our year. Mum's read all of his books, and Duncan's brother is amazing at tennis. He's only in sixth form, and he's already won a couple of junior tournaments. Duncan certainly acted as though he had his own part to play in his family's fame. He walked through the school corridors with his head held high, like a celebrity on the red carpet, and he barely spoke to anyone except his two best friends. It was as if the rest of us weren't worth his attention. Today, he didn't even raise his eyes to look at the class. Instead, he cleared his throat and shifted his weight from one foot to the other. There was a long silence, during which he seemed to be thinking.
"This one is called The Cabin," he said eventually. "It's about a dead man in a cabin. You'll see."
He read confidently and did his characters in different voices, but it was obvious that his story hadn't been well thought through. A body was discovered in a cabin in the middle of a snowy forest. A detective was called to the scene and found that there were no windows and the only door was locked from the inside. When he forced his way in, he saw a man with a stab wound in his neck and a bucket of bloody water beside him, but nothing else. I could tell straight away what had happened. It was a variation of a riddle that Jack had told me years ago. The man had been stabbed with an icicle. I rolled my eyes at how obvious the answer was. Duncan must have spotted me as he finished reading, because I could see a pink glow in his freckled cheeks. His eyes narrowed slightly. I knew that look.
"Thank you, Duncan. A promising start. There's certainly some impressive characterization. I think you could work on building the suspense. We have time for a couple more. Any more volunteers?"
I avoided Mrs. Emmett's gaze, but I should have known that this was the wrong tactic. Jack used to have her for English, and he'd warned me that she always picked on the people who least wanted to be chosen.
"Felicity, do you want to come and share the opening of your story with us?"
I nodded, even though I hated reading my work aloud. I could feel Duncan's gaze on my back as I walked to the front of the class, and I made a point of looking straight at him before I started reading. As always, he refused to catch my eye.
"It's because he likes you," Kira insisted.
"I mean, really likes you. I've seen him looking at you when he thinks you won't notice. Why else would he do that?" But I didn't agree with her. Duncan was just strange, and it was probably his way of trying to make me feel uncomfortable. I still remembered the moment we'd met on the first day of term last year.
"So your name's Flick?"
he asked, when we were walking down a corridor between lessons.
"Yes."
"It's peculiar, isn't it?"
he asked, and I couldn't tell whether he was making fun of me or if he was really curious about it.
"It's short for Felicity," I explained, although I'm sure he knew that.
"I'm Duncan. I've recently moved over from Florida,"
he said in his American accent, which only added to the impression that he was genuinely famous.
"And where are you from?"
"I'm local," I told him. "I grew up here and I went to Ellerton Primary." I instantly felt like the least interesting person in the world. That was the thing about Duncan. Even if he said very little, he managed to get under your skin. Today I tried to ignore him and cleared my throat awkwardly. "Lady Abigail Jackson hated Christmas shopping. Every year she thought about sending one of her maids instead. What she wouldn't give to avoid the tedious crowds, the gridlock of horses in the streets and the freezing cold. But she always ended up going herself, much to her household's dismay. It was partly because she had no idea what to buy, and also because she didn't trust anybody else to do the job well. The children, of course, insisted on going with her. They wanted to see the huge Christmas tree outside St. Paul's Cathedral and to visit the new chocolate shop that had opened on Cheapside. Margot had worn her new red beret for the day, and Henry flew out of the house with no coat, so his sister had to chase down the road after him. There were even more people in the streets than she'd expected. It took them an age to cross Blackfriars Bridge, as the children kept stopping to admire the view of the Thames on this crisp December morning. Mother, there's a carol service at St. Bride's," said Margot, pulling her sleeve. "Can we go and see, just for a minute?" Lady Abigail agreed,
After all, Margot didn't often get a chance to enjoy herself. Ever since Lady Abigail's husband had died 4 years earlier, she'd put her efforts into making sure her children were well set up for life, and that Margot in particular knew how to take care of herself. She had struggled after his death, but she'd learned how to manage the servants in the estate, how to do the accounts and take charge of her children's education. In addition to Margot's regular lessons with her private tutor, she received guidance on how to be a proper young lady. When they reached the church, Lady Abigail grabbed Henry's arm to stop him from making a run for it. Luckily, the little rascal seemed overwhelmed by the crowds pouring down the narrow lanes to St. Bride's and was sticking close to her. But when she turned back to look at the choir, she realised that she couldn't see her daughter. "Margot!" she screamed. "Margot!" The crowd around her shifted, alarmed by the volume of her voice. "Have you seen my daughter? She was wearing a red beret." The women around her shook their heads. The men parted to let her pass. The sound of the choristers stopped. She was aware of people joining the search. They shouted questions. "How old is she? What colour hair? How tall?" She answered them quickly, her eyes scanning the church. Then, above the heads of the crowd, she saw a red beret being passed to her. When her fingers closed upon it, she felt a sudden pricking sensation. Attached to a pin was a piece of card showing a tiny picture of a bell. "It was lying by the front steps," said an elderly lady. Lady Abigail stayed at the church long after the crowds had left and spent hours walking the streets of London shouting her daughter's name. But Margot was nowhere to be found. I'd meant to stop reading much sooner, but somehow I'd managed to reach the end of what I'd written. When I looked up, I saw rows of faces staring at me expectantly.
"That's sensational," said Mrs. Emmett. "I'm honestly lost for words."
She was looking at me with an expression I'd never seen before.
"I want to know what happens next,"
I heard one of the boys in the front row whisper.
"Well, you'd be pleased to know that homework is composing your next chapter," said Mrs. Emmett. "If you're keen, you're welcome to post your work on the class intranet for others to read. If Felicity decides she wants to do this, you'll all have a chance to read her next instalment. It's a bit weird to have lessons in being a young lady,"
I heard Duncan say.
"Was that actually a thing?"
"In Victorian England, that was quite common in wealthy families," said Mrs. Emmett. "They wanted to ensure their daughters would marry well, and the best way to do that was to teach them how to behave appropriately and attractively in society. Of course, things are very different for girls and women now."
I looked in Duncan's direction, interested to see how he would take this response. But I didn't get a chance to find out, because at that moment there was a knock on the door and Mrs. Lyme, the school receptionist, came in.
"Felicity Chesterford, could you come to Mrs. Singh's office?"
She was trying to keep her voice steady, but I could sense that something bad had happened.
Chapter 3. I followed her along the corridor to the head's office and, when she opened the door, I saw Dad. There he stood in his work clothes, but they were wet and his hair was plastered to his forehead.
"What are you doing here? How come you're soaked?"
I asked. He looked down at his drenched clothes as if he'd barely noticed them, and then I saw the fear on his face. I'd never seen him scared before. He was always in control. It was part of his job as a barrister to be logical and never emotional. I didn't know what was going on.
"It's Jack," he said. "There's been an earthquake in Peru, near Lima. It happened early this morning. We didn't want you to hear about it and worry. Mum and I haven't been able to get hold of him yet, but I'm sure we will."
"What?"
I laughed in disbelief. Time slowed down. Suddenly, something in my stomach jolted. It was that feeling you get before you're going to be sick. I pelted through the door and into the nearest toilet, where I retched until there was nothing left in my stomach.
Afterwards, I slumped against the door and breathed in greedy mouthfuls of air. The strip lights on the ceiling multiplied before my eyes. I knew that I couldn't go back to class. I returned to the head's office where Dad was waiting for me. I took his hand in the way that I'd done when I was much smaller, and together we walked to the main doors, both feeling bewildered. I could see through the windows that it was still raining heavily. It was as if the world knew the awfulness of the news we'd been delivered. "Do you want to get the bus?" I muttered to Dad.
"Let's walk," he answered quietly.
After signing out at reception, we left, passing the blur of brick that was the new primary school and the fields where we'd played football with Dad when we were younger. I focused on my feet, black smudges against the squelchy green and brown. Raindrops nestled in my hair and then trickled their way slowly down the back of my neck.
"He's going to be all right, though, isn't he? They'll find him and he'll be all right," I asked Dad desperately.
Of all people, Dad would know what to do. He dealt with some very tough cases. Surely he would be able to make this okay too. He took a long time to answer. Unbearably long.
"I don't know, Flick,"
he said eventually, in a voice that didn't sound as if it belonged to him at all.
"The truth is that I don't know."
My chest contracted. We walked on and on through the streets until eventually the rain stopped and we reached our scratched red front door. I noticed I'd been clutching Dad's hand so tightly that his knuckles had turned white.
"Mum's home," he said.
But for some reason, instead of ringing the doorbell, I got out my keys. I made straight for the stairs. There was only one place I needed to be. I ran up all three flights without bothering to take off my shoes. When I reached the top floor, my feet stopped at the threshold of his room. I'm not sure what I expected to see. Jack's room greeted me in silence. Dust particles danced. I'd always come in without knocking, but today it felt wrong. I had to stop my hand from rapping on the doorframe. There was something about his room that I'd always loved. It wasn't the size, although apart from the living room, it was the biggest room in the house. Jack had the whole top floor to himself. Dad said that an artist had lived in the house before us, and he'd converted the attic into a studio, with a skylight and a window overlooking the street and the river beyond, and a little seat on the ledge where he could look out and ponder the world. The place was messy but cosy, with Jack's stuff still lying around. There was the soft smell of chocolate and washed sheets mingled together, and the spotted rug that always flipped upwards like a curl of hair.
"Howdy,"
I said into the quiet. I forced my right foot inside and slowly made my way to the bed. I took out my phone and called Jack. It went straight to voicemail. I tried again a minute later with the same result. I hadn't really expected him to answer, but I felt a sudden desperate need to hear his voice. I replayed the video clip he'd sent me on my birthday when he was on the beach in Brazil. His nose was so sunburned that it had begun to peel. He was lying in a deck chair, eating watermelon. He seemed relaxed and happy, but there was a tiny shake in his voice when he said he missed us. I lay face down on the duvet and breathed in deeply. It wasn't as strong as before, but I could still smell that faint sweetness. Then a thumping began in my head, like a tiny drummer beating a fierce, sad rhythm. My hand reached and felt for the roughness of the chocolate frog packet. Out of the corner of my eye, I spotted a hair, a single blonde strand, short and thick. I stared and stared at it until my vision blurred. Picking it up carefully between my thumb and forefinger, I looked for something that I could put it in. Suddenly, there was nothing more important than making sure that hair was safe. I scanned Jack's desk, then I kneeled down and peered under the bed, which was home to his most prized possessions. Half-empty packs of cards, used for some of his more imaginative tricks. Scrapbooks of ideas and pictures of friends and people he admired. When he was younger, my brother used to take his scrapbooks with him everywhere, even to school. He sketched his funny tricks, jokes he'd invented, and notes on how to bring them to life. I could vividly remember his first detention. He thought it would be funny to put plastic cups of water along the corridor. When everyone came out of class, they had to navigate their way to their next lesson via a huge obstacle course. Obviously, loads of water spilled in the process, and the corridor soon became very wet. When somebody else was about to get the blame, Jack owned up. That was something everyone knew about him. He would never lie, and he always took responsibility for what he did. Mrs. Singh was a great head, and Jack didn't always get caught. But his tricks didn't stop, and after many incidents, she must have written Mum and Dad a strongly worded email, because Dad sat Jack down for a chat. Mum was at her after-work yoga class, which was a shame.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.